Earth has two deep frozen polar regions, Antarctica at the bottom and the Arctic at the top. From space, they look very similar, but a closer look uncovers a vastly different story.
If you look at the southern hemisphere, we have a continent covered by ice, surrounded by ocean, and in the north, we have an ocean covered by sea ice and surrounded by continents.
Arctic sea ice, on average, has decreased by 13% each decade over the past 40 years. Melting ice makes sea levels rise, but not this ice. To unlock that contradiction, we have to understand the difference between sea ice and land ice.
It's almost as if you think of having a glass of water filled to the very brim with floating ice cubes. When those ice cubes slowly started to melt, that's not going to overflow the glass of water because the buoyancy of the ice is taken up by its lighter density. And so that's the same analogy to think about with sea ice. When it melts, it doesn't raise sea level.
But if ice cubes melt in a second glass, and that new water is poured into the first glass will overflow.
So with land-based ice, we have a very different consequence than we see sea ice melting. It's really the melting land ice that we need to be concerned about as we're looking at sea level rise.
So, while melting Arctic sea ice doesn't raise sea levels, melting land ice certainly does in glacier-filled countries like Greenland and here in Iceland.
Like 5 years ago, I would be standing in the middle of a glacier where I'm standing right now, because that's how much the glacier recedes.
While the glaciers themselves don't reach the ocean, their meltwater can eventually make its way into the North Atlantic.
The pieces that are breaking off are getting bigger, and they're breaking off faster and faster. So that's how the ice sheet actually causes sea levels to rise. And this is undoubtedly caused by climate change and human-caused global warming.
The hotter the climate and warmer the ocean, the faster the ice melts into the sea. But in Iceland, fossil fuels aren't the only culprit. The land of ice and fire has 32 active volcanoes, five of which have had major eruptions since 2010. And when the volcanic ash settles on top of nearby glaciers, it attracts an unwelcome guest, sunlight.
So this is the ash from the 2010 eruptions. The blackness absorbs more heat than the white material, so the sunlight doesn't get kicked back out into it, so it actually makes things warmer over time.
Which causes this glacier to melt faster and contribute to global sea level rise, which since 1880 has increased by around 9 inches. But if a ticking time bomb at the bottom of the Earth goes off, that could literally be a drop in the ocean. This is Thwaites Glacier, a mass of ice the size of Florida that acts as a cork, keeping the behemoth of the Western Antarctic ice sheet from plunging into the ocean. If that happens, sea level rise will be catastrophic, which is why Thwaites has been nicknamed the Doomsday Glacier.
Thwaites, it's a very difficult environment. It's very dangerous. Your life is constantly at risk.
For the first time in millions of years, the South Pole region is losing ice. Between 2002 and 2020, Antarctica shed an average of 149 billion metric tons of ice per year.
Thwaites is the most vulnerable glacier on Earth because it's perhaps the most unstable.
This is Thwaites, the Doomsday Glacier. A mass of ice the size of Florida, holding back Antarctica's gigantic western ice sheet.
Because it's unstable, that's how it got the moniker, Doomsday Glacier.
Between January and March 2022, Dr. David Holland braves brutal conditions on Thwaites as part of the MELT project, a team researching how and why it is thinning and retreating about half a mile every year. To unlock that question, they look deep below the glacier in a zone around the grounding line.
And now the actual drilling has begun this morning. And so they're down a few meters now.
The approach we've taken is to drill through the ice using hot water. And before it freezes back over, you can put a string down, a wire string, with things like temperature sensors.
The team discovers the water here is 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit above freezing. And that's bad news. Thwaites lies on Antarctic bedrock that dips below sea level. Where the bedrock and the glacier meet the water, you find the grounding line. When warmer water penetrates the grounding line, it melts the glacier from below. As the grounding line moves back, ice once on land calves off into the sea, and the forward flow of the glacier accelerates.
It's grounded on a seafloor bump. Should it be triggered off its current bump that it's hanging onto, there's nothing to stop it from retreating from where it is today all the way back to the South Pole.
And if Thwaites goes, all of the ice in West Antarctica, a mass the size of Alaska, will likely follow.
If it should all melt and be replaced by ocean, the melted ice would spread around the planet, raising sea level up to 10 feet.
Even 1 foot of sea level rise would have devastating consequences for many people in the United States living near the seashore. Now, we don't expect that anytime in our lifetimes, but hundreds of millions of people will definitely be affected by sea level rise over the next 20, 50, and 100 years. So it's definitely a big concern.